ये इम्पोर्टेंट पॉइंट आपने बताया एक्सेस टू टेक्नोलॉजी का, क्योंकि अब ये जितने प्रोग्राम्स मिले हैं इनको अमेरिका से,
हाँ
एनक्रिप्टेड कम्युनिकेशंस के और लॉजिस्टिकल फैसिलिटीज के और जियोस्पेशियल इंफॉर्मेशन इंटेलिजेंस के, ये तो उनकी कैपेसिटीज को मेनी टाइम्स बढ़ाएंगे, तो इसके हिसाब से
हाँ
तो
प्लस इवन दी ऑपरेशनल व्हीकल्स, जितने भी बेस्ट हेलीकॉप्टर्स, बेस्ट LLMP जो पोसाइडन है, वो उनका सारा वो तो चल रहा है।
चलो वेले ओ नी रहे
हाँ
अल्टीमेटली तो देर हैज टू बी ए फॉलिंग आउट बिटवीन यूएस एंड इंडिया, क्योंकि वो ज्यादा देर चलेगी
अच्छा
नहीं
चलें देखते हैं। हाँ क्योंकि
क्योंकि
इंडिया,
चाइना पे पिवटेड है ना सारी, होल स्ट्रेटेजी इज नॉट बिकॉज यूएस लव्स इंडिया, इट्स मेनली बिकॉज यूएस इज कम्पीटिंग विद चाइना, सो देयरफॉर दे नीड ए समबडी, हमेशा ही उन्होंने ये किया कि कोई ना कोई आए उनके
हाँ
लिए
कोई ना
साथ,
कोई कोई सरोगेट मिल जाए, कोई क्या
सरोगेट
कहते
मिल
हैं
जाए जिसको वो
लड़ने के
आगे
लिए मिल जाए कोई। हाँ
बढ़े।
लेकिन अभी चूंके दी अमेरिकन, सॉरी इंडियन डायस्पोरा इन अमेरिका इज सो मच, सो ऑब्वियसली द इन्फ्लुएंस इज बोथ वेज,
या
इन्फ्लुएंस इज बोथ
दैट्स गुड।
वेज।
अब
हाँ
तो इंडियन एग्जेक्टिव साइड पे डेमोक्रेट्स में तो हमेशा बहुत अंदर हैं, गवर्नमेंट के अंदर
हाँ
हैं काफी।
हाँ तो सम ऑफ देम ब्रिंग व्हाट द अमेरिकन एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन वांट्स देम टू टेक,
हाँ
वो उनके अपने एम्स हैं, इफ दे हैव टू अचीव दोज एम्स तो दे हैव टू
हाँ
टो सम ऑफ द लाइंस
हाँ हाँ
बाय द एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन, वरना तो वो चल नहीं सकता काम।
हाँ वहाँ इवन थिंक टैंक्स एकेडेमिया में तो थे ही, बट यूएस कांग्रेस में मैंने स्टाफर्स में बहुत इंडियन इनरोड देखे।
बहुत हाँ हाँ बिकॉज दे आर टेक सेवी, दे आर स्मार्ट with respect to education and
हाँ
so they can socialize also, drink chahenge वो सब कुछ कर सकते हैं, they have,
हाँ
तो वो they have a free
हाँ
run actually।
दे
सर टाइम हो गया सर, विद योर
जी,
परमिशन सर।
बिस्मिल्ला बिस्मिल्ला करें।
बिस्मिल्लाह रहमान रहीम, आज की तकरीर का आगाज हम तिलावत कुरान पाक से करेंगे।
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم شروع اللہ کا نام لے کر جو بڑا مہربان نہایت رحم والا ہے
إِنَّا أَعْطَيْنَاكَ الْكَوْثَرَ
اے نبی صلی اللہ علیہ وآلہ وسلم ہم نے تم کو کوثر یعنی بہت زیادہ بھلائی عطا فرمائی ہے
فَصَلِّ لِرَبِّكَ وَانْحَرْ
تو اپنے پروردگار کے لیے نماز پڑھا کرو और कुर्बानी किया करो।
إِنَّ شَانِئَكَ هُوَ الْأَبْتَرُ
कुछ शक नहीं कि तुम्हारा दुश्मन ही बेनाम रहेगा।
बिस्मिल्लाह रहमान रहीम, डिस्टिंग्ड स्पीकर्स, वाइस एडमिरल खाना श्याम बिन सद्दीक, मैनेजिंग डायरेक्टर बहरिया फाउंडेशन, कमोडोर बिलाल, बाबर बिलाल हैदर, डायरेक्टर नेशनल इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ मैरीटाइम अफेयर्स, डॉक्टर सैयद अकील अख्तर नकवी, एक्टा SPD, एंड मिस्टर सुफियानुल्लाह, रिसर्च फेलो एट द सेंटर फॉर इंटरनेशनल स्ट्रेटेजिक स्टडीज। डियर पार्टिसिपेंट्स, लेडीज एंड जेंटलमैन, अस्सलाम वालेकुम। माय नेम इज वली कासिम मुस्तफा एंड आई एम डायरेक्टर एट द आर्म्स कंट्रोल डिसआर्ममेंट सेंटर एट द इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ स्ट्रेटेजिक स्टडीज इस्लामाबाद, एंड आई एम ऑल्सो द मॉडरेटर ऑफ टूडेज इवेंट। Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of Institute of Strategic Studies Islamabad and Arms Control Disarmament Center at the Institute, I warmly welcome you all on today's webinar on India's naval modernization and its impact on strategic stability in South Asia. Ladies and gentlemen, as we know that India has remnants to rise to a great power status and wanted to achieve its hegemonic ambition through military means. It is constantly maintaining its position among the top five biggest military spender in the world. In 2020, with its US$72.9 billion military expenditure and a total world share of 3.7%, India was ranked number third. India is allocating huge resources on its ongoing military modernization drive. It has allocated around US$18.48 billion for the purchase of weapons in its 2021 and 22 defense budget. And out of this, the Indian Navy will receive around $4.5 billion for weapons purchase this year alone. Currently, the Indian Navy operates around 150 ships and submarines, and it's planning to have around 200 ship fleet by 2027. India operates one nuclear-powered attack submarine, one ballistic missile submarine, and 15 diesel electric submarines. The second SSBN, known as INS Arigat, is expected to join the service this year. The Indian Navy has also begun construction on the remaining two Arihant class submarines, S3 and S4. India also operates one aircraft carrier, INS Vikramaditya, and its indigenous aircraft carrier, known as INS Vikrant, is expected to be commissioned next year. And more recently, in June 2021, India has cleared a $7 billion project to build six new generation satellite submarines, and there are many other projects which India is pursuing with the help of its own industry and with the help of external suppliers. Ladies and gentlemen, India has not only introduced nuclear weapons in South Asia, but has also added the nuclear dimension in the Indian Ocean. India's building of Triad and offensive military preparedness is aimed against its neighbors. Its ongoing naval modernization has severe implications for regional peace and security. So with this premise, the ACDC has organized this webinar to explore the following questions. Number one, what are the dynamics of a competition in the Indian Ocean region? Number two, how Indian maritime modernization is going to impact the balance of power in South Asia? Number three, how Indian development of sea-based nuclear capabilities are going to impact deterrent stability in South Asia? And number four, what are the repercussions of India's maritime strategy for regional security architecture? So with this brief introduction, we'll now formally begin on our webinar. I would like to invite Ambassador Zaz Ahmed Chaudhary for his welcome remarks. Ambassador Zaz Ahmed Chaudhary, before joining the Institute, has served as a member of the Foreign Service of Pakistan for 37 years. He served as a Foreign Secretary of Pakistan for over 3 years. His last diplomatic assignment was as an ambassador of Pakistan to the United States. He has also authored a book titled Pakistan Mirror to Dutch Eyes. Sir, you have the floor now, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Qasim. I must say that this is one subject that has always intrigued me. One, because I don't know much about it. And two, because I get a hunch that there's a whole maritime world that is going to be affected by the evolving geopolitical realities, i.e. The US-China competition in the Indo-Pacific region. So I see every reason for Pakistan's intellectual and think tank and academic circles to focus on this domain as to what are our capabilities and what are the vulnerabilities. But beyond that, we also need to focus on our eastern neighbor, which unfortunately has pitched new levels of hostility towards Pakistan in the recent years, and has now embarked on what you rightly, Qasim, said, hegemonic ambitions vis-a-vis South Asia. We can very clearly see that the US tilt towards India has been interpreted by the Indian present dispensation in power, Prime Minister Modi's government, as treating South Asia as its area of so-called area of influence. And therefore, I see that overall military modernization in India has increased manifold. The budget has increased, the indigenization programs have increased. And as we just rightly talked about before the start of this program, their access to technology because of strategic partnership with the US has also increased. So we need to really monitor those developments. In 2019, when India embarked on a surgical strike against Pakistan and their two planes were down, there was also some activity in the maritime. And there too, our naval apparatus was able to detect a submarine Indian in our waters, the Indian submarine. We also see that in the years to come, Port of Gwadar will gain considerable importance. Although for us it remains an economic project, but our adversaries tend to see it as also as a strategic access to China, to the Indian Ocean. So there's a lot there on the plate, and I'm truly excited to listen to this array of speakers that you have gathered, especially Vice Admiral Ambassador Khan Hasham bin Siddiq, because he has vast experience of both worlds. And therefore, we are keenly looking to listen to him and to other speakers who I'm sure have an impressive set of information that we've shared with us today. So a warm welcome to every speaker, and back to you, sir.
Thank you, sir. So now I would like to invite Ms. Ghazala Yasmin Jaleel to give us a quick briefing on today's subject. Ms. Jaleel is working as a research fellow at Arms Control Disarmament Center, and her areas of expertise are arms control, disarmament, nuclear issues. Ms. Ghazala, you have the floor.
Assalamu alaikum and good morning to all the esteemed speakers, the Director General, the Chairman. Good morning and welcome to the webinar. So I will very, very quickly try to go through what kind of modernization India is doing. I do not want to encroach on the subject area of the speakers. So I have tried to keep my briefing very, very limited.
Qasim, we can't hear her.
Size by half in the next decade or so to become one of the top naval powers in the world. So coming to Indian naval capabilities, this is what India has at the moment. It includes one aircraft carrier, destroyers, mine sweeping vessels, patrol vessels, and others. So, and then India is constantly improving and adding to its naval capabilities. It has not only tried to boost its indigenous naval vessels building capacity, but it has also done a fair amount of acquisitions from abroad. India is building and acquiring around 40 warships and submarines. These include stealth destroyers, anti-submarine corvettes, stealth frigates, and it, as has already been mentioned by Director ACDC, it already has one aircraft carrier, and it is also working on the second one, and its sea trials have already taken place in August 2021. A number of other capabilities that India is acquiring, it's inducting a MiG-29K aircraft, came off 28 and 31 helicopters on its aircraft carriers. It has purchased 8 maritime reconnaissance and anti-submarine aircraft. It is also set to acquire MH-60R Seahawk helicopters. And it also has been offered MTCR Category 1 and main aerial systems. The Sea Guardian US, and is set to receive 30 of them. Then again, India has acquired anti-submarine warfare aircraft, anti-ship harpoon missiles, and it also improving its amphibious warfare capabilities. Overall, these acquisitions would immensely improve Indian reconnaissance capabilities, its war fighting capabilities and anti-submarine capabilities, and would provide the Indian Navy a strategic outreach in the Indian Ocean. Then coming to nuclear submarines, India continues to develop its naval component of the nuclear triad, and it is building a fleet of 4 to 6 nuclear-powered submarines. The first one, Arihant, has already been inducted, and it's capable of carrying 12 K-15 submarine launched ballistic missiles. And the second one, INS Arigat, is also expected to be commissioned later. And that is also capable of carrying 12 K-15 SLBMs. And construction work has already begun on third and fourth one, as already been said. Indian Navy currently consists of one operational SSBN and 15 diesel electric attack submarines. So these are just details of those submarines. Most of these are the electric ones. And then some of them are the nuclear powered one, the Arihant class ones. So, and then these are India's sea launched missile that it has at the moment. It has BrahMos, which is a cruise missile. Dhanush and Nirbhay is also being developed. That's a cruise missile, Sagarika, or also known as K-15, and then the K-4. It has a 3,500 kilometer missile under development. So India's development of a large nuclear submarine force will have adverse effect on deterrence and crisis stability in South Asia. Nuclearization of the Indian Ocean is a threat to all the littoral states, especially for Pakistan, which aims to maintain a credible nuclear deterrent against India. The introduction of its nuclear triad would create command and control issues and increase chances of unauthorized accidental launch. Indian plans to build large naval force, conventional force, is also a cause of concern. It presents a set of challenges for Pakistan. It is thus imperative for us to discuss how Indian naval modernization would affect the balance of power in South Asia. And we also need to debate what should be Pakistan's options in the face of Indian modernization at sea. So without further ado, I will hand the floor back to Qasim so that we can hear from the experts. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Ghazala, for giving us a brief introductory overview of Indian Navy and its growing capabilities. Ladies and gentlemen, we are honored to have among us Ambassador Vice Admiral Khan Hasham bin Saddiq. And Ambassador Khan Hasham bin Saddiq is a recipient of Salal Imtiaz Military and Star Imtiaz and graduated from Pakistan Naval Academy and won Sword of Honor as Best All-Rounder Cadet. He also attended the National Defense University, where he attained his MSc in Joint Warfare, MPhil in National Security, and later attained his MS in War Studies from Qaid-e-Azam University. Ambassador Hasham is also a graduate of the Naval Postgraduate School in Monterey, California, the United States, where he graduated with an MSc in Operation Research. During his service in Pakistan Navy, he enjoyed a distinguished career, having attained the vast experience of both command and staff appointments. The Honorable Ambassador Hasham has served as a Vice Chief of Naval Staff. He also served as Pakistan's Ambassador to Saudi Arabia and permanent representative at the Organization of Islamic Conference. He joined IPRI as a president in March 2019 and is Managing Director of Beria Foundation University, Beria Foundation. Now I invite Khan Hasham bin Saddiq to give his remarks on dynamics of competition in the Indian Ocean region. Sir, you have the floor now.
Thank you much. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Ambassador Azaz Chaudhry, Ambassador Khalid, Director ACDC, Qasim Saab, my fellow panelists, Assalamu alaikum and very good morning. Let me begin by thanking my dear friend Azaz and the Director ACDC for having invited me to discuss an issue which is obviously being an ex-naval officer is very dear to to anybody associated with maritime arena. And also a very timely and very, very important subject. So it's a great pleasure and always a great opportunity to interact with so many enlightened speakers. What I'll do is that since the webinar or there are four, three other speakers, so I'll tread with caution and so as not to sort of take the thunder out of their subsequent talks. So I'll handle today's subject in three broad areas. One is I would want to establish an overall context and an overarching framework within which this competition or a conflictual situation is likely to appear in the Indian Ocean and perhaps understand some of the grand underpinnings for all the situation that we are confronted with in it. Similarly, I'll also briefly discuss why Indian Ocean is important, who are the stakeholders, what are their current objectives. But I leave it to the subsequent participants to talk about the Indian naval strategy or the US strategy, but I'll briefly touch upon that. And finally, a bit about how Pakistan, how do I view Pakistan's role and future strategy. I'm sure each one of you would agree that the global geopolitical landscape is in a flux. And particularly our region is in transformation. And as we understand that the seat of power remains on land. So whatever happens on land, whatever geopolitical moorings there are, some of the fallouts or the effects permeate into the maritime arena. So that's the overall context that the whole world is in transition, and I'm sure you know it better than I do. Similarly, one of the conclusions which is oft referred is that the global center of gravity has shifted east. And as they say that the 21st century is touted to be Asian century. And that's where the arena for conflict and competition is likely to exist. If the center of gravity lay in the heartland of Europe in yesteryears, the space for the future is inevitably going to be maritime. So the other point to note is that the geopolitical framework of future is not just Indian Ocean. So it is more Indo-Pacific. But today I will restrict my observations with respect to Indian Ocean, but future is Indo-Pacific. What happens in Pacific Ocean, especially the South Pacific and Indian Ocean, will determine. And I'll resist the temptation of using Mahan, which said that the Indian Ocean is where the destiny of the world will be decided. So that's the overall context. We also know that there is primacy of geoeconomics and over geopolitics. So therefore, you hear this blue economy and this $30 trillion wealth that lay beneath the within the seas and on the surface and beneath the surface. And as the resources on land become scarce, so it will be extremely vital to not only have access to sea resources, unbridled access, to be able to exploit those resources. And that's where the future of the whole world is, or the mankind is. It is virtually untapped. All you hear is some offshore oil and mineral discoveries, but there is the energy which can be harnessed from the sea, and there is the aqua culture that exists. So that's where the competition for access to resources, and even if you have to access to resources on land, the means is through sea. So unless you have a control or some sort of stability, there will inevitably be a competition or a complex. The third or the fourth, shall I say, everybody knows that there is a rising China and there is a declining power of the US across the world. Now, how this transformation or transition to the new world order takes place, whether it will be a conflictual or a cooperative transformation, the jury is still out. But if this process was to start at 2030, but with the Trump's administration, this competition or conflict with US having declared China as a in their national security strategy as a threat. So that's where the competition and that's where the flux that has ensued because of this. Now let us look now at the Indian Ocean region. As we know that this is the third largest ocean, there are 30 little states and 11 landlocked states which are tied to Indian Ocean. It covers about 20% of the Earth's expanse. And if you look at it, there are actually five distinct regions within Indian Ocean. The Middle East and the Gulf generates entirely different dynamics what South Asia does, or let's say East Africa does. So there are the countries within this are widely dissimilar, so diverse that so there is no cohesion as such within this this Indian Ocean. So the politics of it or the economics of it or the military aspect of it, they're very, very diverse. If you see at in the Gulf, there is this US-Iran standoff. If you see in the Red Sea and Horn of Africa region, there is this Yemen conflict. And then we have this failed state of Somalia and ensuing piracy. So the whole body politics of associated with the Indian Ocean is very, very complex. And Southeast Asia and Oceania region with Australia, Indonesia, and Malaysia, it's a different world. And the dynamics are absolutely different. As I said, that nearly 42% of the conflict, active conflict in the world, are associated with littorals of Indian Ocean. Whether it is Afghanistan, Yemen, or Somalia, and so many conflicting situations. And that's why you see that there are some failed states as well. There are failing states, there are failed states within this region. So that's how it generates that security dynamics or the geopolitics within the Indian Ocean. As mentioned by the speakers and Ambassador Azaz as well, Indian Ocean states are heavily armed. It is a nuclearized nation. As Thomas Barnett said, that this is the most militarized area of the world, and it requires stability the most, so as to speak. We have talked about Indians' expenses or expenditures on defense and modernization of their navy. Similarly, we have not only the little states, but also extra regional forces with their permanent bases. The US has 12 bases, France, UK, China has base in Djibouti. Russia is building a base in Sudan so that they can have access through Red Sea to the Indian Ocean. And then you have Italians, you have Danes, and all kinds of people in this. And obviously, India does have its due share with their outposts in Maldives, in Mauritius, and La Reunion, and so many other places. So it's a plethora of people, actors, vying for influence within this region. We remember that when 1968, the British, the colonists, sort of left Indian Ocean. It was followed by a Cold War rivalry between the US and Russia, And then we had a brief foray into unipolar world. And now there are multiple actors, some regional powers like India, Pakistan, Indonesia, and then the extra regional forces. The other thing to notice is then there is this specter of non-traditional threats. India, Indian Ocean is notorious for drug smuggling. There is the possibility of terrorism. Thankfully, international community has cooperated to control that, and no major incident has taken place. But you always run into arms smugglers. Some of the war in Yemen is being abetted through sea, and so many other conflicts are actually. All in all, there is this geostrategic rivalry, and then regional rivalries, and then we have this non-traditional threat. Also, Indian Ocean is prone to tsunamis, and it is the hottest ocean in the world. And then environmental issues also take precedence within the Indian Ocean. And we need to understand that why is it in state of flux? There is no region-wise security mechanism within the Indian Ocean. All we have is a bit of some arrangements like IONS, which is the Indian Ocean Naval Symposium, of which Pakistan is a part. Then we have this IORC, but largely just like SAARC, they have been very, very ineffective. Similarly, the bilateral arrangements are also not very, very robust, so as to speak. We've talked about then the political dissimilarity between the literals. There is this specter of conventional armed conflict, whether it is between inside the Gulf or between India and Pakistan because of the political disputes, or even going into nuclear configuration. So all in all, that's the politics and the military part of it. And let's see what is the economic imperatives which drive or underpin the dynamics. Since geoeconomics has primacy over geopolitics, the Indian Ocean has the most vital slots going in the world. Nearly half of the containers traffic, 35% of the bulk cargo, and the oil supplies emanating from Middle East with gas guzzlers like Korea, China, Japan, and India, who have such big appetites for imported crude and petroleum products from the Gulf, that it's a strategic necessity for all these and the other literals that the sea lines of communication are secure. Unfortunately, the intra-region trade, which may have sort of created stakes amongst the literals in Indian Ocean, is only 20%. 80% of the trade within Indian Ocean is extra-regional. Hence, you have all these actors coming into Indian Ocean to protect and see to it that the global trade is not disturbed. So the interest within Indian Ocean is not only regional, but it is more extra-regional. And now superimpose this, the Belt and Road Initiative, which traverses the Indian Ocean to Africa, to Middle East, and eventually Pakistan as well. And remember the acrimony that exists between the US and China, and their appetite, or so as to say, their motive to disrupt this BRI, the Silk Route part of BRI overseas, or at least have a semblance of influence and control over this. So that drives, again, a competition or a conflictual situation in the Indian Ocean. Obviously, the main actors are U.S., which has this avowed policy of containment of China, and also access to resources and project power whether it is for their operations in Afghanistan or in the Middle East, they need access to Indian Ocean. And that's why their permanent presence with two carrier strike groups and expeditionary strike groups. Obviously, India being one of the regional hegemon with so much of spending considers India as India's ocean, Indian Ocean as India's ocean. And within the Quad framework, they would want to be as the net security provider. I think Commodore Babri Bilal will talk about it more in his talk. And then we have China, which has this Malacca Strait dilemma, where the vital POL supplies and their trade to towards the Indian Ocean can easily be disrupted by forces that are inimical to the rise of China. So if you may summarize, it is the US-China rivalry that interlocks with China-India rivalry within the Indian Ocean. So that's the grand part of the competition or dynamics within the Indian Ocean. And as I said, then we have the regional players like KSA would want to keep their influence within the Gulf. Iran also has ambitions with respect to Strait of Hormuz, then Malaysia, Indonesia, and we need to understand that within the Indian Ocean, the geography is such that this is a closed ocean. So anybody who controls the three choke points, that's the Strait of Hormuz, Gulf of Aden, and the Malacca Strait, and you can include the Mozambique Channel as well, and the area around the Cape of Good Hope, whosoever controls these can choke and possibly influence events by merely controlling these sea lines of communication. And that's why you see this competition and conflict with various amongst various powers. From Pakistan's standpoint, I'm sorry, I've treaded over my time limit, but from Pakistan's standpoint, perched in the northern part of Indian Ocean, we are a bona fide maritime nation. We have critical stakes in not only the vital POL supplies, the nearly over 90% trade is overseas, so our exports and imports. So similarly, we have nearly 55,000 square kilometers of area, easy, including the continental shelf, to protect, to be able to exploit those resources. And similarly, we have nearly 1,000 kilometer coastline to defend, which is sparsely populated at the moment. And last but not least, the CPAC will remain merely a road corridor unless we secure the maritime component, the trade which we hope to transship at Gwadar Port, unless we have a maritime component which ensures the security of this. So overall, from Pakistan's standpoint, we want a peaceful, a stable, and a legit maritime order to prevail that is based on rules within the Indian Ocean. And last but not the least, then the specter of their Indian Cold Start doctrine and proactive operations, where Ambassador Azaz mentioned that their forward presence of submarines that could possibly disrupt our critical sea lines of communication, then the possibility of an armed conflict in conventional domain and God knows to nuclear configuration, I think that also. So in conclusion, as I said, Indian Ocean holds the key to the future of mankind. Let me just say that seas are shared wealth. This is a common heritage, and this has been so. Sea is not proprietary to anybody. It's an international setting. So the more we cooperate and avoid these competition and conflictual situation, there is enough in the pie for everyone to benefit from gainfully from the sea. So it's a truly international, and I think Pakistan is going the right way with cooperation, whether it is CMCP or other bilateral cooperation with the regional states. Lastly, the blue economy, which we sort of touting about, I think we are yet to realize that potential. And for that, we need cooperation. We need forces that can maintain that lawful order. And finally, I think we need to have a sea-based deterrence, because weakness invites aggression, and that in an international setting has to be achieved through your own indigenous capability and cooperation with other global and regional players within this Indian Ocean. So thank you so much, and my apologies for taking a bit long.
No problem, sir. Thank you very much, Ambassador Khan Sham Sahab, for giving us a very comprehensive overview of the challenges being faced in this region, Indian Ocean region, and option and choices for Pakistan. Ladies and gentlemen, now we'll move to our next speaker. Our next speaker is Commodore Babur Bilal Haider, Star Imtiaz Military. He is director at National Institute of Maritime Affairs, NIMA. Commodore Bilal is a retired naval officer and currently working as a director at NIMA. During his distinguished career, he has served on various command and staff appointments to include commanding officer of Frigate and Corvette, director PNTS, Deputy Naval Secretary, commanding officer PNS Dilawar, and directing staff NDU. Presently, he is a research fellow at NDU in International Relations Department pursuing his PhD. He is also visiting faculty in Berea University in Islamabad. His area of interest include Indian Ocean region, maritime diplomacy, traditional and non-traditional security threats in Indian Ocean region, and maritime security. Commodore Babur Bilal Sahab, you have the floor, sir.
Thank you very much, sir. Ambassador Azad Chaudhry, distinguished panelist, ACDC, ISSI team members, respective participants, assalamu alaikum. I will be sharing some slides also, so let me first get those slides. In next 12 to 15 minutes, I'll take this liberty with the approval of Madam Ghazala also to take more time. I will be talking on the Indian maritime modernization implications for the balance of power in South Asia. Before I embark on this 10 to 15 minutes talk, let me tell you that what is Indian Navy? Indian Navy is a four-dimensional force with strategic assets, satellite support, and mature combined commands of Navy and Air Force operating in various places. They have also matured their Army and Navy joint command also. So they are forced to reckon with in Indian Ocean. I will be talking through this. This is my scheme of presentation, after historical some perspective, some statistics, although Zala has covered a little bit, but it is more in detail. And then we will have some naval aspirations, Indian hegemonic designs in Indian Ocean, perceived strategic vision, and finally, some implications for Pakistan will be discussed. We all know that Indian military strategy under Nehru, which he said in 1954, and I quote, "If you peep into the future and nothing goes wrong, wars and the like, the obvious fourth country in the world after US, Soviet Union, China is India." So that is their concept. So they equate themselves in the big powers. Indian military strategy since 66, the time is 66 because they had a thrashing in 65 war. Earlier they had a war skirmishes with China also. So they embarked on a proper development plan from 1966 onwards. Initially, they were having the defensive posture in 65 war, and thereafter they opted for the offensive postures. Indira Gandhi continued, and in the same line, they exploded the nuclear device also in 1974. 86 was the first year then the India started using the naval forces for overseas deployment to support their own missions, that is to evacuate Indian nationals from Germany in 86, peacekeeping force in Sri Lanka, and defeat of coup in Maldives in 88. Rajiv Gandhi also demonstrated the government's growing propensity to use its military power to achieve political ends. These are general statistics. 4,500 miles long coastline India has, 351 islands. Andaman and Nicobar Island has about 600 miles from the mainland, and that is very strategic island they have, and they have now established the amphibious force headquarters also there. Indian exclusive zone is about 1.2 million square miles. It provides them this 50 to 80% of the country's oil and natural gas. Another 30% of our oil comes from the Persian Gulf and is delivered by ships along the, with 97% of Indian trade is through the sea. India has 16 major, 20 intermediate, and 150 minor ports. They handled 1.3 billion metric tons. Comparatively, Pakistan handled 90 million metric tons in one calendar year last year, and look at their figure. The Indian merchant fleet strength is about 1,200 vessels, ranked 17th in the world. India has several economic and military centers, Madras, Bombay, Bhabha Atomic Research Center, etc. Indian Navy has been entrusted with the responsibility to guard said facilities and secure its locks. That is one of the major thing. Coming to the Indian Navy, strategic platforms and capabilities, submarines, aircraft carrier, reconnaissance, research vessel, and amphibious is included in the strategic capability. First is submarine, which they have one and they are making, and there are total submarine, conventional submarine, and six. They carry missiles. This Ariane class submarine may be carrying the nuclear tipped missiles also. Indian aircraft carrier, Kiev class, they have one in their inventory with 26 to 30 fighter MiG-29s and six AW ELOs, a good platform of this size. But this is the new addition, which is very important to mention, that INS Dhruv, this is a research vessel. They claim it is a search vessel, but probably it can track the incoming nuclear tipped missiles also. So this has to be seen, and they are making another one also. And the fourth is their strategic capabilities, the amphibious force. They can lift about Devian size force also. They have long list of vessels in their inventory. And now they are also making some new fast speed, high speed vessels for this purpose. Coming to the Indian Navy surface capability, again, stealth destroyers, guided missile destroyers, all with missiles, helicopters, fully equipped vessels, long list. Corvettes and patrol crafts, again, they have some stealth platforms. They are all equipped with missiles, offshore vessels. Even there are small Coast Guard vessels also carry the helicopters. So look at the inventory. They have a very formidable surface fleet to reckon with. Moving on to the Indian Navy development strategy. Indian Navy has been focusing on developing indigenous platforms, systems, sensors, weapons as part of Navy's modernization and expansion. As of 2020, India has about 41 vessels of various types under construction, including an aircraft carrier, destroyers, frigates, corvettes, conventional-powered submarines, and nuclear-powered submarines. All are being manufactured in Indian yards. Indian Vice Chief of Naval Staff, Vice Admiral Puri Jizan, has outlined that India aims to become a 200 ships navy by 2027, noting that the current force stands is at 137. In December 2020, Indian Chief of Naval Staff said, and I quote, India has transferred from a buyer's navy to a builder's navy. This is, look at the plans. Arihant, that is the nuclear ballistic missile submarine, SSBN. They want to build four more. One is operational, one is under trial, and two are under advanced stage of construction. S5 project approved. Probabilities are still on the drawing board. Chakra, which is Akula class submarine, they are planning to have one more. Again, this will be delivered by 2025 to them. Scorpion submarines, the conventional ones, three is already operational, two under trials, and one is under construction. Project 75, attack submarines, India, their proposal has been cleared and it is still on the drawing boards. Midgets, small vessels. Aircraft carriers, already have one, and they are also making the second is ready for commissioning somewhere next year. Whereas INS Vishal is again seen as a replacement to the Vikram Aditya. Probably in the 10 to 15 years time, it will be available to them. Indian class of landing platforms, that is the amphibious warships. They have some, not now they are making a formal force, so they are inducting more and more platforms in that category also. Destroyers, long list, frigates, corvettes, they are making it, because they are making themselves, but there are certain projects which is still on the drawing boards, but some has been cleared, some has been, the initial amount has been sanctioned, so they are in the process of getting the those things through their own shipyards. Mine countermeasure vessels, they are planning to have 12, and others.
You have a mute here. What?
Okay. Just hold on. I think it's missed the. Now coming to the aircraft, they also planning to induct twin engine deck based fighters for their new aircraft carrier. It is still in the design phase, a long tall to go. Carrier borne fighters, they are probably getting from US, France, RFIs for 36 aircraft. Some P-8Is, they already have some, and they will be getting more from the USA. Helicopters, they want to replace their old Sea King also. So they are modernizing at the same time replacing, and they are also constructing themselves. This is the new platforms, or new inductions in the unmanned aerial systems. They have some, and now they are also under some procurements, and they are also indigenously developing it. Indian naval aspirations. Since 1966, India have endeavored to convert from a coastal water naval defense force into a relatively modern fleet. The basic concept was the capable of guarding Indian national security interests, projecting Indian military power throughout South Asia. The primary objective of Indian Navy is to safeguard the nation's maritime borders and in conjunction with other armed forces of Union, act to deter or defeat any threat or aggression against the territory, people, or maritime interest of India, both in peace and war. Indian Navy mission spans the entire extent of Indian Ocean, including Southeast Asia and East Africa. India defines her maritime interest as in the four bullets which has been shown on this slide. Protection from threat by the sea to Indian independence, exploitation of sea resources, protection of sea trade, and to promote Indian's influence to the other littoral states. Not in the Indian Ocean, but away from the Indian Ocean also. To achieve these objectives, Indian believe in deterrence. That is the first thing which Admiral Kohli also said. Looking generally at the Navy's peacetime functions, we find that it is primary one is deterrence. They want to have a sea control for a longer period in the Indian Ocean. Presence, they want to be present in the areas of interest and probably areas of influence also. Power projections in the area of interest and influence, physically present and showing their vessels, monitoring the big powers' navies moves in the Indian Ocean. That is one of their aspirations, and the Coast Guard's duties, policing duties, acting as a policeman in Indian Ocean behalf of the great powers. The bottom line of India's naval strategy seems to have expressed by the Admiral Kohli. which I quote, India cannot be content to limit to the nuclear submarines of the power trawling around the Indian Ocean and not be able to deter them in any way. The presence of an Indian attack submarine would make them think twice before undertaking such a deployment. The most important component to the naval strategy India has adopted since 71 has been to increase the power of Indian Navy, both quantitatively and qualitatively. Indian Navy desires to influence South Indian Ocean region, South China Sea, and be recognized as a global maritime power or player. Indian Navy is investing in development of nuclear submarines, carriers, stealth ships, missile tracking capability to be recognized as a great maritime power at global level. India has a formidable Dvian-sized amphibious force, which I already told you at Nicobar Islands. Development plans of Indian Navy has a specific connotation, which are development of nuclear submarine and the long-range nuclear missiles is manifestation of fact that India has acquired assured second strike and triad capabilities. Development of two aircraft carrier are indicative of Indian ambitions to project its power even beyond Indian Ocean region, that are smaller countries of the region impose sea control as and when required, and to challenge major powers if situation so arises. Development of amphibious capability is considered for power projection and keeping the smaller countries in check. Present and future inventory of Indian Navy ships would make it capable to control all the slogs passing through Indian Ocean, as already mentioned by Admiral, as Indian Navy strength would outweigh the total number of naval units of all littoral states of Indian Ocean region in times to come. Indian Navy wants to dominate the Indian Ocean region in general and South Asia in particular through deterrence, diplomatic initiatives, and establishing hegemony over different countries. On diplomatic front, they go for security growth of all in the region. That is the Sagar initiative. They talk of this initiative. They have already done exercises with the Quad partners, US, Japan, and Australia. In 2021, they had the first ever Indian Navy RSN exercise also. Again, the maiden exercise with the Algeria Navy also. In July 2021, UK Carrier Strike Group and Indian ships also exercised in Bay of Bengal. India and Singapore inked a submarine rescue support pact. India, Indian Navy and USN has a logistics exchange memorandum of agreements to use their ports for each other. Efforts to export BrahMos missile and Akash air defense system to Saudi Arabia and UAE is also there. Agreement with Indonesia and Oman to gain access to Sabang and Dukem port have already been inked. Logistic agreement with France is also there with the port of Reunion Islands. Look at this map, just depicts you the four coastal surveillance radar stations away from the Indian shores. They are monitoring the whole Indian Ocean through these four stations. Indian motivation is to build a blue water navy and formidable force motivated by India's dream to emerge as a global power. Result of closer strategic alignment with the US and its allies to counterbalance China, India is already a regional hegemon in the Indian Ocean, threat to all littorals of the South Asia. Intentions can change overnight versus capability, which requires longer period to develop and attain sufficiency. Today's India, a blue-eyed state of US and allies, can pose a real challenge to even US and allies themselves. Interest in times to come. Indian nuclear ambitions are a threat to all the littoral states, but especially to Pakistan. Indian naval nuclear development will qualitatively alter the strategic balance between India and Pakistan. For Pakistan, introduction of nuclear triad is a threatening development which further exacerbates its security dilemma vis-a-vis India. Pakistan has a small economy and cannot afford to develop a large fleet or compete in the conventional domain. In addition, supporting acquisition of conventional arms by India, by US and West, is further tilting the conventional balance of power towards India, thus pushing Pakistan further to rely on its nuclear capability, both on land and at sea. Indian naval expansion is undermining the naval stability in the region. Pakistan needs to develop a second strike capability in order to complete the nuclear triad to preserve the credibility of nuclear deterrence. India, with a formidable navy and maritime infrastructure, is developing into a naval monster, which I call it, in Indian Ocean. Indian naval muscles in Indian Ocean and future planned inductions will make it the bull in China's shop, which will be certainly challenge the combined naval arsenal of all other states of Indian Ocean region and global powers. Indian naval development will also have far-reaching effects on naval environment in Atlantic, Pacific, and Southern Asians, oceans. It is thus need of the hour for Pakistan and other like-minded states of Indian Ocean region to increase interaction, cooperation, and interdependence to safeguard their legitimate maritime interests against Indian challenge in Indian Ocean. With this, I thank you for patient hearing, and we will be, inshallah, discussing the question on session if there be. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, Commodore Babar Bilal sahab, for giving us a very comprehensive presentation on Indian Navy strength, its modernizing capabilities, and its future projections, and also giving us an overview of recommendation and choices for Pakistan. Ladies and gentlemen, now we'll move to our next speaker. Our next speaker is Dr. Sayyed Akil Akhtar Naqvi. Dr. Akil works on nuclear non-proliferation, safety and security matters at the ACDA branch of the SPD. He did his PhD in peace and conflict studies and master in strategic security studies from the College of International Security Affairs, Washington, D.C. He is a former visiting research fellow at the International Institute of Strategic Studies, London, and has delivered talks at several national and international institutions, including University of Oxford and King's College, London. He is a former naval aviator and has flown several aircrafts, including Sea King and the submarine helicopters. Dr. Adil, you have the floor now.
Thank you, Qasim Saab, and thank you very much for inviting me to this forum. I'll restrict to the test and try to compensate for my previous speakers and try to finish my talk in less than 10 minutes time. I'll try to briefly cover three aspects related to my topic. First, the understanding of SSBN and strategic stability. Second, conception of sea-based nuclear forces in India, China, and Pakistan nuclear postures. And lastly, implications of India's sea-based deterrence on strategic stability of South Asia. With the advent of nuclear weapons, the core challenge for decision makers was to devise a strategy to prevent a catastrophic first strike. If a preemptive first strike is able to destroy the enemy's entire nuclear forces before the enemy could respond, a first strike remains a plausible option. Contrarily, if the first strike is assured of retaliatory nuclear response, it would theoretically outweigh any benefits gained by striking first, thus make a first strike less likely. Hence, an assured sea-based second strike capability evolved, which stabilized deterrent relationships among nuclear powers. Nuclear armed states maintain higher number of nuclear weapons to minimize chances of losing them in first strike. After having an assured second strike capability with the development of a potent SSBN force, a state does not have incentives to further enlarge its nuclear arsenal and thus minimize arms race incentives. Thus, a highly survivable SSBN force should contribute to both crisis and arms race stability by reducing the incentives for preemptive strike. However, this simplistic perspective does not cater for developmental and operational factors, which present a more complex matrix of ground realities. Now, coming to the nuclear postures of India, Pakistan, and China. India's strategic objective of developing sea-based nuclear forces is to achieve deterrent stability. We already know in much greater detail about the Indian Navy SSBN force developmental programs. So I'll just skip over and move to the Pakistan's part, why Pakistan responded to Indian developments. Pakistan's pursuit of sea leg of nuclear triad is based on necessity to maintain credibility of deterrence. Development of Babur III missile is a restrained response to Indian naval nuclear program. India's wavering stance towards NFU policy suggests that role of SSBNs is not limited to assured second strike capability. It may also employ this capability in preemptive strike missions. These trends directly challenge the survivability of Pakistan's land and air-based nuclear assets. In China, currently, four Jin-class SSBNs are in operation, while Type 096 are under construction. Jin-class submarines are equipped with JL-2 SLBMs with a range of 7,000 kilometers, and the next submarines would be equipped with JL-3 missiles with estimated range of 12,000 kilometers. China considers that SSBN force will significantly enhance credibility, reliability, and effectiveness of its nuclear deterrence. Coming to the China-India deterrence relationship, India's efforts to develop an assured second strike capability against China have been met with a restrained response from China. China is developing its nuclear forces to absorb a possible US first strike and subsequently inflict an unacceptable damage to the US, which is much larger and far superior than India. China's land-based missiles are enough to strike all targets in Indian territory. Furthermore, Chinese SLBMs can reach all of the India from South China Sea. So China considers that its existing nuclear forces are entirely capable of dealing with India. Coming to the factors affecting crisis and arms resource stability in South Asia. Presence of ready-to-fire nuclear weapons on SSBNs has escalatory effects during crisis. In the aftermath of Pulwama standoff, India's hasty deployment of SSBNs demonstrated its inclination and readiness to bring in the nuclear factor in India-Pak conflict situation. The irresponsible and ambitious use of nuclear assets, particularly in an environment that already exhibits the dangers of escalation or early use of nuclear weapons, is detrimental for regional peace and stability. SSBN deployed with pre-mated weapons is at highest level of readiness. India may have to maintain higher alert levels if it decides to deploy SSBN on continuous at-sea deterrence patrols, which should be a significant departure from existing nuclear posture. Command and control challenges associated with SSBN immensely impact crisis stability. It is highly difficult to maintain uninterrupted communication with a dived SSBN. SSBN communication stations are also likely to be preferred targets of the belligerents. In case of communication breakdown, decision makers face two basic challenges. SLBMs will be of no use to the nation, and second, there is a strong likelihood of unauthorized missile launch in case of a bolt from sky situation. Such uncertainties compel decision makers to launch nuclear weapons earlier than necessary. To avoid such situations, policymakers are generally inclined to pre-delegating launch authority during crisis. Any decision to pre-delegate launch authority on Indian SSBNs would enable naval commanders to launch SLBMs within minutes without any legitimate political oversight. During Cold War, nuclear powers adopted two basic strategies for deployment of SSBNs. One, continuous at-sea deterrence, or CASD, or bastions, or a citadel strategy. UK, France, and Russia deploy at least one SSBN continuously at sea, while US deploys a number of SSBNs on CASD based on its operational requirements. Indian SSBNs are constricted by technologies for CASD deployment. If India adopts CASD in haste, its SSBNs would be vulnerable during crisis, which may put escalatory pressures on submarine commander and thus straining crisis stability. Now coming over to arms race stability. If SSBNs are less survivable due to technical and operational shortcoming, as it is in the India's case, a state would require larger number of nuclear weapons as well as more conventional maritime forces to protect its SSBN force. If a country adopts bastion strategy, it has to shift from a sea denial to a sea control strategy, which requires significant enhancement of conventional maritime forces. Expansion of maritime forces would exacerbate security dilemma between nuclear adversary, intensifying nuclear competition and arms race. This would only exacerbate arms race, particularly in South Asia, requiring Pakistan to take remedial measures to restore deterrent stability. Hence, development and deployment of SSBN changes security metrics of belligerents, which rekindles nuclear and conventional arms competitions. Belligerents may be less threatened if they believe that opponent SSBN force has been developed for defensive ends. However, if SSBN program is driven by prestige, bureaucratic interest, and an effort to mirror great power actions or rising national sentiments like India, the security dilemma between nuclear armed states is likely to exacerbate, leading to arms race. So with this, I'll come to my conclusion and say that India's regional political ambitions, active role in the US strategy to contain China, and access to sophisticated military programs will further aggravate its adversarial relations with China and direct implications for Pakistan. In current scenario, New Delhi pursuit of sea-based nuclear capability contributes to aggressive posturing. In Pakistan context, India's sea-based nuclear assets not only provide second strike capability, but also offer potent weapons to carry out preemptive strikes. The planned fleet of 5 to 6 SSBNs equipped with multiple nuclear warheads would change security metrics of Indian Ocean, exacerbating arms race incentives. While rising rivalry in Asia Pacific exhibit serious risk of conflict escalation between China and India. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. K. Adil, for giving us a very comprehensive presentation on the subject. Now we'll move towards our last speaker. Our last speaker is Mr. Sufianullah, Research Fellow at the Center for International Strategic Studies. Sufianullah is a PhD candidate at Department of Defense Strategic Studies, Khyber University, Islamabad. He is currently working as a research fellow at CIISS and visiting faculty at Department of International Relations, National University of Modern Languages. He is former visiting fellow at Center for Non-Proliferation Studies, Monterey, California. Mr. Sufian, you have the floor now.
Assalamu alaikum, ladies and gentlemen. Am I audible, please?
Please go ahead.
Okay. Thank you. I thank Mr. Qasim Usfasab for the kind introduction. It is a pleasure for me to be a part of this August panel and share my views on a topic that is extremely important and very timely. I personally see India's maritime strategy from a geopolitical context, and I believe that this strategy aims to complement New Delhi's broader foreign policy agenda and aspirations. So my talk focuses on how India's assertive maritime strategy contributes to its foreign policy considerations. While India remained a reluctant power for many decades, it has adopted assertive foreign policy in the 21st century. And as similar to theory of securitization, the US and its allies use Beijing as a referent object to securitize China's rise, construct the China threat theory by projecting it as a revisionist power, and develop counter strategies that we often see in the form of growing military cooperation and forging of new alliances. So in the midst of growing Sino-US competition, I believe India finds a moment of strategic opportunity to which it wants to respond by becoming a major power that is capable to alter the international system. Nevertheless, the key question here is that whether India behaves like a defensive power that is satisfied with the status quo, or an ambitious state that prefers expansion of power to be a hegemon in the Indian Ocean region. I think that while India has not yet embarked upon any anti-system strategies by demonstrating a classical revisionist behavior, but it aspires key changes within the system to increase its bargaining ability. These aspirations are reflected in few trends that I would like to highlight. First is that it's diplomatic rhetoric that particularly towards the regional states in the form of minimized engagement through SARC. Then we see a retreat from a multilateral approach in India's foreign policy behavior as it adopts a policy of exclusive minilateralism that involves greater cooperation among a smaller number of states and not a larger number of international actors. Then we see the urge to seek strategic supremacy over its nuclear adversaries. It is quite evident from recent events and the development of India's evolving nuclear posture and the changing doctrine. The whole debate is there, which contextualizes how India is aspiring to achieve strategic supremacy, particularly vis-a-vis Pakistan. Then at part of India, we see that there is a greater willingness to initiate and escalate military crises. It was also demonstrated in February 2019 crisis with Pakistan when Modi issued statements like Qatal Ki Raat, and India very hastily deployed nuclear submarines in the Indian Ocean against Pakistan. And lastly, the restructuring of composition of United Nations Security Council to attain veto power status that would allow it to shape political consensus on key international issues. So I repeat, my key point here is that I think India has not yet embarked upon any anti-system strategies, but these are the few trends that reflect that India is not very much content or satisfied with the status quo. Rather, it wants to change the liberal political system to an extent where it gets more bargaining ability and it can exert its power. In this regard, I think that India's maritime strategy is designed in a manner to complement to these trends. So about India's maritime strategy, my key argument here is that India's maritime posture is gradually shifting from defense to preeminence with an intent to exert influence far from its shores. Now, how has this thinking developed in India in past few years? At Commodore Babur also pointed out a few things. I would like to refer to India's early maritime strategists like Panikkar and Vaidya, who emphasized that developing advanced naval capabilities. Panikkar proposed that Indian Ocean should remain truly Indian, while Vaidya asserted that Indian Ocean must become an Indian lake. So this kind of thinking laid the basis for the hegemonic tendencies that were to shape the country's regional aspirations in the years to come. And this emphasis, along with the influence of Mahan's thinking, as Vice Admiral Hasham also pointed out, the influence of that Mahan's thinking on India's maritime aspirations, this inculcated the thinking of forward presence in Indian Navy's mindset and also influenced how it approached relations with the neighboring states. In recent years, this strategy focuses on operating beyond the Indian Ocean. But how are these objectives being achieved? And what are the strategies that India is trying to adopt to pursue them? I think we need to identify different prongs of maritime strategy and how they synergistically work to pursue these desired objectives. So in my modest assessment, I believe that India's maritime strategy has five broader components. First of this component is the development of advanced naval capabilities. This has been adequately covered in the initial remarks by Mr. Qasim Mustafa, then Mr. Ghazala, and then Commodore Bilal very adequately talked about it. So I won't go into detail, just to highlight that the plan is to produce around 197 warships by 2027, then a fleet of 28 submarines. It already operates a nuclear attack submarine acquired on lease from Russia, while the government has approved the project to indigenously produce 6 more nuclear attack submarines. The key point here about nuclear attack submarines, I would like to point out that while a non-proliferation treaty was being discussed, this aspect was deliberately ignored and was not brought under the sanctioned item that nuclear attack submarine is not considered as a nuclear weapon. So it was deliberately kept ambiguous, deliberately kept out of the scope of the NPT, and hence it allows the trade, not purchase or sale, but on a lease, you can give your nuclear attack submarines to other states. However, we observed that in February 2019 crisis, as this statement said, India deployed nuclear submarines in the Indian Ocean, in the Arabian Sea, I mean. The use of plural term submarines actually represents only has 2 submarines, one ballistic missile submarine and a nuclear attack submarine. So this actually implies that India actually deployed both of these submarines in that crisis. So one has to see that how India intends to use this submarine against Pakistan that it has acquired on lease from Russia. The second aspect of this maritime strategy, I think, is a new regional construct of Indo-Pacific region. Though it has recently gained salience in modern lexicon of geopolitics, and I believe that it is quite a bit unnatural construction of a region, because Indian and Pacific oceans are both geographically separate oceans. However, by constructing this new regional construct, Indo-Pacific, US actually wants to conjoin these two oceans into a one single strategic system. A strategic system by we refer to a situation in which any development in one part of the region directly implicates the other parts of the region anywhere, irrespective of the distance from that point. So I think one of the primary reasons behind replacing Asia-Pacific with Indo-Pacific construct by US is the hope for Indian cooperation in containing China and maintaining a desirable order at sea. From Indian perspective, this concept aims to legitimize its security role in both Indian and Pacific Oceans. Successive US administrations have viewed India as a key player to hedge against China's rise. Engagement under this framework allows India to acquire new military technologies from the US. Now, few examples include purchasing P-8I aircraft and attack helicopters for maritime surveillance and anti-submarine warfare. India divides this so-called Indo-Pacific region into two areas of primary and secondary interests. The water bodies on India's coasts, including the Arabian Sea and the Bay of Bengal, these constitute the area of primary interest for Indian Navy, while it is also preparing to exert greater influence in the extended regions exert influence in the coming years. In the extended regions, the secondary regions include the regions like South China Sea and other regions that are beyond the Indian Ocean. I think that this terminology to replace Asia, which actually represents a whole continent with the word Indo, it magnifies India's stature from a meager South Asian power to a growing world power. India is already working on enhancing engagement with states around South China Sea. Joint military exercises with Singapore and friendly port calls to countries like Brunei, Malaysia, Indonesia, and Philippines, and also Vietnam. This brings Indian Navy into these distant and disputed waters. India has established deep water maritime facility at Campbell Bay, and Baz is the name of that facility, is the most southerly point of Andaman Islands, which enables it to conduct surveillance and operations over South China Sea. Therefore, the use of Indo-Pacific region construct goes beyond the mere use of terminology and is manifested in the deployment of naval assets and India's naval cooperation with states that are beyond the scope of Indian Ocean. The third element of India's maritime strategy is to be a part of emerging quadrilateral security alliance. And we have recently seen a paradigm shift in India's engagement with extra-regional powers. Though it claimed to pursue a policy of non-alignment for decades, however, it has recently entered into strategic partnerships like this one that I mentioned, the Quadrilateral Security Alliance. This Quad Alliance actually thrives upon the China threat theory that I previously mentioned to justify their growing security relationships. The notions like free and open Indo-Pacific region and rules-based order inherently carry an anti-China orientation and only promote selective imposition of certain rules for a favorable region order. This strategy seeks to contain rising China from different sides and relates to constructivist explanation about why and how India and other like-minded states project negative impression of China's rise to pursue a desirable security architecture. Being a part of a Quad Security Alliance, India gets access to sophisticated military technologies. I will just name a few agreements like Logistics Exchange Memorandum of Agreement, then COMCASA, that is Communications Compatibility and Security Agreement. Then we have BECA, Basic Exchange and Cooperation Agreement. And lastly, General Security of Military Information Agreement. So the advanced warfighting capabilities directly undermine military balance in the region, provide strategic advantage to India during potential crises with adversaries, and also allow it to project sea power against its immediate neighborhoods. Similarly, establishing naval bases for forward deployment is also a significant component of New Delhi's naval strategy. India is constructing the first overseas naval base in Seychelles, which, because of its strategic importance, will allow it to monitor sea lines of communications and to support naval operations by technologies like coastal radar systems. And Commodore Babat showed us the map to better contextualize this importance of this development. Then, to enhance geographical outreach, India has gained military access to bases of several other countries like Indonesia and the Dukem Port of Oman. And the cooperation at the strategic level is not going just with the US. India has also signed these logistic support agreements with France and recently with Australia as well. Well, to contextualize this growing capability, I believe that for an ambitious state, enhanced military force provides distinct political objectives like protecting or revisiting the status quo, deterring potential aggressors, or reassuring your allies. But for India, I think these capabilities allow it to exercise influence and subdue potential rivals in the region. The fourth significant element of India's maritime strategy is projection of India as a net security provider. And I think this buzz of being a net security provider has grown louder in official and academic discourse in last decade. But the lack of consensus on its meaning keeps it open to different interpretations. However, simplistically speaking, I think the term net security provider implies that a country is capable to pursue its own interests as well as it is able to provide security assistance to other states in the region. And this capability actually depends on four elements. The first one being the capacity building, in which a net security provider has the ability to assist that in training of other states' security forces. Second is military diplomacy, in which you establish military to military relations like joint exercises and making port calls. And India is engaged in regularly conducting Milan and Malabar exercises that involves a good number of international actors. Then third requirement is the ability to provide military assistance in terms of military technologies to the certain friendly states in order to deal with the common challenges. Now, those common challenges could be any. Those could be anti-piracy, counter-terrorism. But in my opinion, once India uses this notion of net security provider, this military assistance is actually provided to only those states that are willing to catch ball with US against its drive against in containing China's rise. So I think there is a need to contextualize it with the overall notion that I start that this strategy actually complements India's foreign policy approach. Fourth one is the problematic for India because it involves a net security provider actually is required to be able to directly or physically deploy its forces to influence the outcome of crisis. And I think it directly depends upon your political will as well as military capabilities. And recently we have seen in the Galwan crisis that India is actually not very much capable to defend its own interest. How come can it be very much capable to secure the interests of other states unless those states are driven by power politics and are aimed against a chosen few states? Thus, the notion of net security provider, I believe, can be problematic in a region where competing states hold divergent strategic and political aspirations. So the difference in the interests will only lead to mistrust and generate an environment of competition. But recognizing the fact that US has limited capabilities to engage at both Pacific and Indian Oceans, and this is something that is very often written by international experts and scholars, that India, US can retain its dominance in the Pacific, but it has limited capability to govern the affairs of Indian Ocean. Thus, I think it is trying to actually outsource this security role in Indian Ocean to India by making it a net security provider so that it could elevate its stature and balance China's increasing influence. So this containment of China is actually the shared objective of both US and India, and the something that provides oxygen to India's maritime strategy. The last component of this maritime strategy is the nuclear leg of India's nuclear triad. But since Dr. Akhil has already covered this aspect in detail, I shall not go into much in depth, but only share a few observations that I personally think that SSBN's actually add to deterrence stability because they offer you a more survivable retaliatory capability. It is actually very hard to detect and strike a moving nuclear submarine that is hiding under the water. However, in India's case, I think we need to view it in connection with its overall evolving nuclear posture. In recent years, India's nuclear posture is shifting from these retaliatory strikes to counter-force targeting missions, where it wants to acquire a capability whereby it could actually detect adversaries' retaliatory capabilities and has the capability to precisely strike those capabilities. Now, if you see at the technical features of India's submarine launch ballistic missiles, the range of K-15 Sagarika ballistic missile and the precision capabilities of its upcoming K-4 missile, these are highly accurate missiles that can be used in a counter-strike mission. And also, it gets more worrisome. This scenario gets more worrisome once we contextualize the overall debate surrounding India's possible shift from this retaliatory posture to a posture that is based on counterforce targeting strategy. So I think these are the few components or elements that we need to take into account while studying India's maritime strategy. I end here. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Sufyan, for well articulating the Indian maritime strategy and regional security architecture, repercussions for regional security architecture. With this, ladies and gentlemen, we will now move to our next segment. Our next segment is question, answer, and discussion session. And the floor is open for any question. If anybody wants to raise its hand or make a question in the chat box, we're going to put this question to the panelist. So far, we have received some questions from the participants. And the first question is that, what is the most viable option for Pakistan in the face of Indian massive naval modernization, given Pakistan's limited resources, since Pakistan cannot afford to get embroiled in an unchecked arms race? So I'll raise this question for the panelists and ask one by one to respond to this. So first from Khan Hasham Saab. So how are you going to respond to this question? Kindly unmute yourself, sir.
Okay, thank you very much for the question. This is a traditional question to be asked, and this holds true for, but let me put on a military hat, so as to speak. We have to see what are the tasks or what are our maritime interests and what is it that is needed to protect our maritime interests, okay? The ratio between Pakistan Navy and Indian Navy may be a totally lopsided 1:10 or whatever it may be, however you want to grade it. But the question of with a strategic deterrence in place and the kind of conflict we envisage, I think we have devoted sufficient resources to develop our Navy. With respect to conventional capability, the only missing link at the moment is sea-based deterrence. So if our overall military strategy is based on having a credible deterrence backed by a full spectrum capability of. So at the end of the day, in the 2019 episode, you may have seen that it is the what is called in the military jargon TSR, the time, space, and relative strength. The number between Pakistan Air Force and Indian Air Force was 1:3. But on that particular day and that particular time, we were able to bring a Su-30 down and a MiG down with us. And that changed the whole. So it's the question of tactical prowess at that particular time and your ability to be able to strategize in a manner that you're able to safeguard your. So we'll go into long discussion, but this is what I think the nation can afford with respect to the armed forces, not only for the Navy, but also for the armed forces. If you see the recent modernization plan of especially Pakistan Navy, with the kind of inductions, they are unprecedented. and I think the nation can afford. And with the current and the proposed induction, the Navy can hold its sway and hold its own within the overall national interest and our military strategy. So there is no cause for alarm at the moment.
Thank you, sir. There's another question regarding Pakistan's space capabilities, because the participant has highlighted that Pakistan is the dedicated military satellite for its Navy that give its real-time reconnaissance, intelligence, and navigation capabilities. So how you view this, I mean, in comparison with Pakistan's space program plus Pakistan's Navy, these developments, how you view these developments? Maybe Commodore Babar can shed some light on this question.
Sir, coming back to the Indian space program, it is a well-established program, and they have now near real-time space monitoring capability with them, with the military dedicated satellites available to them. Compared to us, we our space program is far behind, and our space program is more for the TV and communication channels and all that it is used. Look at the area of interest for the Indians and look at the area of interest for us. It all boils down to that area. We are more interested maybe in the North Arabian Sea and the SLOCs, where our trade partners. And we can, I think, monitor by other means also. Whereas India has a greater ambitions. They are talking at the global level. And still they are not up to that state like the Americans or the Russians or the Chinese they have now. But there is a very great gap between India and Pakistani state satellite capability also. I think we must endeavor in times to come, hopefully, inshallah, we will also fulfill this weakness with some options available to us. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Ji. Now I'll give floor to Mr. Azam Chaudhary. I believe he wants to ask some questions. Sir, you have the floor now.
My question is with regard to the Quad. I do see that this was essentially a concept by Prime Minister Abe of Japan that there should be a free and open Indo-Pacific, which was essentially a commercial concept to keep the sea lanes of communications open for commercial traffic. But then we saw that it germinated into Quad, which is Australia, Japan, United States, and India. And now we also see them engaging in some kind of military exercises. So my question is, what are the possibilities of Quad becoming actually a military alliance to counter China? And how would that have implications for us?
Thank you, sir. First of all, I will request Mr. Hasham to respond to this question, and then followed by Mr. Sufianullah.
Okay, thank you very much for the question. As you understand, Quad is at the moment a loose arrangement. In strict parlance, the word alliance, I think other than NATO and Warsaw, there have been very few alliances, so as to speak, in the world. It's a more of a cooperation, and wherever the your national interests coincide, and you tend to cooperate. This Quad arrangement turning into a military alliance, I think it is it has a long way to go. India has its own compulsions as well with respect to Russia, because they have quite a significant military hardware from Russia, and they have been their strategic partner. So the jury is still out whether which side Russia wants to be. Similarly, they have these economic relations with China, much that they would want a rivalry, but at with a $100 billion trade. While India would want the best of the both worlds, then it has to do a balancing act between these diverse forces. So therefore, turning into a military alliance, I don't foresee in the near future, because China is not quite ready as yet to venture into any armed conflict, so as to speak, with anybody at the moment. They still have to grow their naval power, their maritime power, to a level where they're able to challenge, or they're able to contest with forces which are opposed to the rise of China. So that's my sense, but I think Dr. Sufyan can be much more pertinent about it.
Sufyan, you have the floor.
Sir, thank you. I personally think that this is a million-dollar question. We cannot have a right answer to this question, but in my opinion is that though it might be a remote possibility, but yet it is a possibility. And in few years, we may see things happening in that direction. There is no doubt about it that China is considered as a significant threat to US and the global regulator. And the NATO summit at the Brussels actually identified China's rise and its so-called revisionist tendencies as being the most primary threat posed to the globe. So threat has been identified. Let's talk about the arrangements that they have having right now. I think it may not necessarily evolve in a manner in which NATO evolved, because the alliance structure and the approach towards establishing new alliances, the US approach, has a little bit changed. Initially, it was based on the model of hub and spoke, in which US was the center and all the other states are actually connected with it. Right now, US is following an approach in which all the alliances are crucial to it, and at the same time, it can maintain divergent bilateral relations with each of those allies. This means that if US is country A and it has two allies, B and C, unlike NATO, it is not necessary if B and C have good relations with each other. US can maintain good relations with those states. That's one point. Secondly, the agreements like BECA, the agreement to share geospatial intelligence and other sophisticated communication technologies that may be used in detecting other countries' crucial military infrastructures, that may be used in operating unmanned underwater vehicles. And I'm talking about autonomous unmanned underwater vehicles. And just to share it, that India has plans to produce. Unfortunately, we did not cover it in our talks. India has planned to produce a whole squadron of autonomous underwater vehicles that can be used in anti-submarine warfare operations. So in context of sharing information, in context of supporting communication, I think Quad can emerge into an alliance that might be working on project-based engagement. It might not be, if I borrow the term, like continued sea deterrence, it might not be an alliance for the permanent basis, but for project-based engagement in a crisis. What if two countries share crucial information with each other? So that kind of cooperation can actually be detrimental for other states like China and Pakistan.
Qasim, can I ask a follow-up question?
Yes, sir. Please, sir.
Slightly different. The United States continues to indicate a narrative that China is also developing its blue water navy, and that it is developing a string of pearls in the Indian Ocean, ending with Kawada. And I was wondering what has been the Chinese perspective on the happenings in the Indian Ocean, one. And second, in response to India being used by the United States as its main partner in the Indian Ocean, is China contemplating any cooperation with any country or the likes of Lemua or Kamkasa or Beka in those domains? Is China really yet ready to engage with any country of Indian Ocean littoral states? Thank you.
Yeah, may I answer?
Please, sir. Go ahead, sir.
Okay. I get the sense what you're saying. In my estimation, China, in order to be the superpower, shall I say, of the world, they need maritime prowess. And as I said, they have some years to go because of the culture and because of the technological gap that exists and the kind of expeditionary forces required to be able to project power and contest control of sea is at least, if not 20 years, at least 10 to 15 years away. The Chinese strategy is based on the grand strategic idea of BRI. And in 2013, when the world was confronted, then you have this Build Better World from G7 led by the US, the Blue Dot, and then you have this North-South Corridor. And so these grand strategic concepts have rivaling concept to it. With military being in supporting caste to the supposedly economic initiative to increase the influence. China, for sure, would want, has already established a bit of presence in the Indian Ocean and the obviously in the Pacific Ocean as well. They would want a permanent bases, much like the other extra-regional forces which have permanence and even the regional powers, as mentioned, the Indian strategy. So they built a base in Djibouti, so they have presence there. Obviously, the other, shall I say, like-minded or somebody who can cooperate, Pakistan has a strategic partnership with China. Certainly in times to come, if they could help, they would have these bases, but through the economic, the pearls, string of pearls, and then you have the Indian nuggets, and then, so these ideas and strategic, to influence strategic landscape will continue to have, and this dialectic will continue. I think, but certainly China would want to have permanent presence, and if they could have military bases in sometime future, that deep down they will have a desire in order to contest US's hegemony.
Thank you, Basusa. Commodore Babaraj. Sir, kindly unmute, sir.
Yes.
Please.
Sir, I just wanted to add to whatever Admiral has said. China basically is a maritime economic power. So what they are doing is, in the old times when the ship used to use the coal as the for the furnace or the steam ships, there used to be a concept of coaling stations that ship used to visit a friendly ports and used to get the fresh water, coal, fresh rations, and had 5-6 days of stop. So what China is nowadays doing is in Indian Ocean is trying to get those coaling stations for times to come. They have already established in Djibouti. Maybe they have secured some rights in Gwadar, in Sri Lanka, in Maldives, Dikumpur, they have arrangements. So they are going for slowly for the to ensure that they have a friendly ports available inside the Indian Ocean. They are probably from the Gwadar port, they are going to make a maritime bridge with the Arabian Peninsula through the Deccan port or the Yemen. And then from the African continent will also be connected to a maritime bridge with the Gwadar port. Similarly, they have already laid a pipeline and the running gas and oil pipeline through Myanmar, which is feeding the southeast of China nowadays. So they are doing it slowly, but they are a force to reckon with. And mind it, Navy's role is to protect trade. If the trade is there in Indian Ocean, the Chinese interest of trade is there, the Navy automatically will be there in this area. So this is the line, because if you can see the role of Navy or the starting point of all the navies of the world, it was always there. Navy's role is to protect trade. So Chinese Navy is going to come in Indian Ocean to protect their maritime interests. So they are doing the same thing. Thank you.
May I add,
thank you very much, Ji sir. Please, Sufyan, please.
Thank you. Just to continue what Sir Babar was saying, it's a historical and long debate that what actually is preferable, a good economy with trade or a good navy. Initially, proponents believed that develop a good economic potential, develop a good market, navy shall follow. But Mahanian thinking said the otherwise. It said that you develop a good navy, develop your outreach, and your trade shall follow. So these are the two models that I just wanted to add. But coming to Ambassador Izaz's question about Chinese perspective on its maritime, or in other words, the naval potential vis-a-vis US. I think China's naval development strategy is slightly different from that of US. Currently, no doubt, US is the most superior naval power in the globe. Chinese model to counter it is not in like developing your weapons to counter the similar weapons. Rather, what we see that China contains the current battle groups and forward deployment of US forces in the disputed region of South China Sea through development of A2AD, anti-access and area denial strategies. China is developing those land-based, shore-based precision strike missiles that can actually disrupt any unwarranted movement of US ships in its closest waters. So the debate on that whether China is a bigger navy or America is a bigger navy, I think it is little irrelevant. Why I'm saying it is a little irrelevant, because if I correctly recall, in 2020 or probably in 2019, the report of Department of Defense, it stated that Chinese Navy is the most fastest growing navy or the most significant or the strong navy in the world. Rather, this is not true. China does not have that potential. China also does not have those interests. Sir Babar rightly mentioned that. China does not have interest to have a sustained presence in Western Hemisphere. On the other hand, US does have that interest in this region. So that it is developing those capabilities like career battle group and things like that. But China's focus is more on economic integration and engaging states through economic interdependence while maintaining those military naval capabilities that are adequate to deny any freedom of movement to unwarranted forces of the adversary. Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Akhil, you have the floor now.
Sir, thank you very much. I just want to add on the quad question and the follow-up question by Ambassador Chaudhary. I would not differ, I would just substantiate what has already been said, but just I add that the Quad participants are increasing their interoperability. So it is a matter of time. It may evolve into a military alliance, it may not, but they are building the capabilities to become an alliance, become a military alliance. And the second part of the question, the follow-up question, what is the Chinese response to the Quad and the increasing Indian influence in the region is, as I understand, spending a little time in China, China is a very sure-footed nation. They don't bite anything which they can't chew. So they are increasing their influence. If they are being contained into the eastern side by the Quad, they're increasing their influence towards the west. They have their legitimate interest in the Indian Ocean, and they have started showing their presence. If you go back into 2011-12 through the piracy operations, so we see their increasing presence of Chinese in the Indian Ocean, and they have a right to protect their legitimate economic interest in this region. And we will see in the future, we will see more of their presence in this region.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, I believe there are a lot of other questions too. Participants wants to ask from the panelists, but due to the shortage of time, we will close our question and answer session here. And we'll move to our next segment, that is concluding remarks by Ambassador Khalid Mahmood, Chairman Board of Governors, Institute of Strategic Studies, Islamabad. Ambassador Khalid Mahmood is a former ambassador of Pakistan to Iran, Iraq, China, Saudi Arabia, and Mongolia. He has served as first secretary and later as deputy permanent representative of Pakistan to the United Nations, New York. He has worked as a director general of the United Nations, additional secretary, United Nations, Asia Pacific, and Africa. former permanent representative of Pakistan to the Organization of Islamic Conference, OIC, and the Economic Cooperation Organization, ECO. Sir, you have the floor.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. See, the subject of this webinar, Indian Naval Modernization and its impact on strategic stability in South Asia, is of vital importance for Pakistan's security in the wider sense, military as well as economic security. Now, we all know that ever since its birth, Pakistan has been seeking security. Our quest for security has been a permanent overriding feature of Pakistan's national policy. Before 1998, this was confined to the conventional field, and Pakistan made various efforts to keep this area, Indian Ocean, as a zone of peace. As we all know that every year, Pakistan brought this matter before the UN General Assembly and promoted the idea of Indian Ocean as a zone of peace. But unfortunately, this initiative, this move was opposed by only two countries in the world, India and Bhutan. So consequently, Pakistan's these efforts and some other efforts also to have restraint regime in this area, in this region, all came to a naught. And whatever the balance was between India and Pakistan, that was disturbed when India went nuclear in 1998. Of course, that balance was restored when Pakistan followed suit. But ever since, the situation has been quite disturbing, to say the least, in this region, so far as security is concerned. And so what we see is that India, from which emanates the direct threat to Pakistan's security, is feverishly not only developing its conventional power, but also in the nuclear field. And this is being now reflected not only at sea, at land and air, but also now increasingly in the Indian Ocean. Now, what are the aims of India, as we, from what I have heard during this webinar, is that India's motivations are to acquire big power status. And to acquire big power status, it knows that it has to be also a naval power. Then it wants to become a regional hegemon, having a veto power, over the policies of the region. Thirdly, of course, it is part of a partner with the United States in countering China. So all these factors are driving India to acquire greater capability in the Indian Ocean. But what's disturbing is that India is nuclearizing the Indian Ocean, of course, it makes strategic stability more shaky, and that end result is that Pakistan has to respond in the interest of protecting its security and economic interests, and a kind of arms race is inevitable, unfortunately. Here, of course, Pakistan is in at some disadvantage because of lack of resources, size, you know. But as was pointed out by Ambassador Hisham, that we cannot seek parity, but there are ways and means how we can ensure our minimum deterrence. And that is the policy which Pakistan has adopted so far and quite successfully. But what is disturbing is the attitude of the big powers. Instead of trying to help the countries of this region to reach amicable relationship, their policies are aggravating the security situation in this region. I'm referring to United States and the Western countries, and even Russia, you know, helping out, assisting India to acquire more and more weaponry, more sophisticated weaponry at sea, which disturbs the security balance in this region. So much so that India has given exemptions from any rules which have been agreed otherwise. So I would say that Pakistan, while keeping its guard and trying to maintain minimum deterrence capability, should also work with other like-minded countries to promote some regional security arrangement which is based on cooperation, and it is rule-based. I know it is a difficult process, but the smaller countries have only law or rule to return to protect their interests. I'm not saying that we should not be working to increase our defense capability, but there are limits to that, given our resources, but we should simultaneously work for to carve out some regional security arrangements here and at the international forum also. So with these words, I want to really acknowledge that I have benefited a lot by hearing the experts and the practitioners in this field, and their recommendations and observations are of great value in charting out Pakistan's future policies in regard to the Indian Ocean. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Sir. मैं समझता हूँ काफी सारे पार्टिसिपेंट्स जो है वो मजीद क्वेश्चंस पूछना चाहते थे ड्यू टू द इम्पोर्टेंस ऑफ द सब्जेक्ट एंड द वे आवर एक्सपर्ट्स हैव गिवन देयर रिमार्क्स काफी सारे क्वेश्चंस एड्रेस हो चुके थे लेकिन वी विल ट्राई टू डू इट इन आवर फॉलो अप इवेंट्स वी कैन अरेंज सम पैनल डिस्कशंस on this subject in future so that all the participants can participate and can raise a different question from such panelists. Iske saath hi hum taqreeb ke ikhtitam pe pahunchte hain. Main tamam participants ka, tamam speakers ka, especially Ambassador Vice Admiral Khan Hisham bin Sadiq, Commodore Babar Ali Haider, डॉक्टर सैयद अकील अख्तर नकवी और मिस्टर सफियान अल्लाह का शुक्रिया अदा करता हूँ कि उन्होंने अपने कीमती वक्त में से टाइम निकाला और इस वेबिनार में अपने रिमार्क्स हमसे शेयर किए. यहाँ पे मैं एक और भी अनाउंसमेंट करता चलूँ कि इस वेबिनार की रिकॉर्डिंग और इससे मुतल्लिका रिपोर्ट्स और फॉलोअप जो चीजें हैं हमारी वेबसाइट पे इंस्टीट्यूट की दैट इज www.issi.org.pk उस पर अवेलेबल होंगी। और यहाँ पे मैं ये भी मेंशन करता चलूँ कि वन ऑफ आवर यंग रिसर्चर इज़ा सैयद हैज़ आल्सो प्रोड्यूस्ड टू इशू ब्रीफ्स ऑन इंडियन मिलिट्री मॉडर्नाइजेशन, तो वो भी आप ज़रूर देखिएगा। और इसके साथ साथ मैं यहाँ पे हॉल में जो मेरी टीम है उसका शुक्रिया अदा करता हूँ, हमारी जो ISSI की IT टीम है और मीडिया टीम है, उन सब के तावन से ये वेबिनार का इनकाद हुआ, उन सबका शुक्रिया अदा करता हूँ। और खसूसन डॉक्टर परवेज भट्ट जिन्होंने हमें फिजिकली यहाँ पे ज्वाइन किया, उनका भी शुक्रिया अदा करता हूँ कि उन्होंने अपना टाइम निकाला। विद दिस लेडीज एंड जेंटलमैन वंस अगेन आई थैंक यू ऑल द पार्टिसिपेंट ऑल द स्पीकर फॉर देयर वैल्यूएबल टाइम। इंशाल्लाह वी विल meet again on similar subjects. Thank you.